I just pray and go to sleep, since half of you are asleep anyways. Amen? All right, well, starting the morning off at 4 this morning is, can't be right in any sense, but that's just the way it is. Praise God for SOPA. Praise God for the event to be able to come and preach. I hope everybody's all right out there. It's, what, 9:30, so I'll sing you a little lullaby and put you to bed, and you'll be all right in the morning. Go over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 7 if you have a Bible, and if you even care at this moment. 1 Corinthians chapter number 7, you know, with the topic radical, it was a little interesting for me to kind of poke out this radical. There's so many things in the scripture that are radical. The word simply means extreme. You know, we hear all the time a radical Islamic terrorist, you know, and you hear all these things. And so you kind of think of the word radical in a negative sense. But on a positive sense, we're pretty much the same thing, only that we're a little excited about Jesus Christ. And so anyways, I want to preach for a couple of moments on the subject, radical distractions, because there's a lot of distractions in this day and age in which we live in, and I know we might veer off, and it might not be a shouting match, if you will, but nonetheless, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 7, if you know anything about your Bible, you know this is a marriage chapter. For those of you that are not married or have daughters or sons that want to be married, it would do you well to familiarize yourself with this particular chapter in your Bible. But go down to verse number 32, 1 Corinthians chapter number 7 and verse number 32. I know everybody's wore out and tired, been in church for over 12 hours now, and I'll just try to put the icing on the cake and take it to the house. Verse number 32, "But I would have you without carefulness. He that is unmarried careth for the things that belong to the Lord." Now, we won't preach entirely on that particular subject, but I can't read it without making mention. Those of you that are unmarried in this room should be caring for the things of the Lord. Now, it's a sorry, low-down shame that people that are not married seem to be more occupied with other things besides God's business, and they don't even have a wife. They don't even have a family. They don't even have a ministry or a church, and it's just them alone day in and day out. Well, the Bible says, look, he that's unmarried, you ought to be caring for the things of the Lord. You ought to be running laps around some of these men that are married. You ought to be running laps around some of these men that are trying to raise 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 children. You ought to be running laps around. And we should not even be able to keep up with you or your itinerary because of what you're doing for the things for the work of God. That's what the Bible says. I'm not adding any commentary to that. Trust me, I didn't read into that verse. That's just what it said. He careth for the things that belong to the Lord, how that he may please the Lord. He that is married, you know what it says, cared for the things that are of the world. Unfortunately, when you get married, guess what? You have a little bit of responsibility. You got to put a roof over the house. You got children to raise. You got shoes to put on your feet. And the prices of all these things are going up and up by the day. And, you know, I remember going to the grocery store when I was a little kid. And for $200, I remember looking at the thing for $200. And I know it's different the further we go back in time. But for $200, we used to be able to fill up the basket. You understand that today it takes about $300 to $400 to fill up the basket in this day and age and to pile it up. And so what I'm saying is prices have gone up. It costs. We have to care for the things of this world. We have to be able to put shoes on our children's feet when they're running around the yard and blowing out their brand new shoes or the brand new Nikes or whatever. We have to care for the things of this world. That's just what the Bible says. I'm not adding to it. The Bible says how that he may please his wife. We got to provide. You know, we drilled the brother earlier. What are you going to do? How much money do you got saved? What are your provisions? What are your plans? What's your career? What are you going to do? How are you going to provide? How are you going to put food on the table? Are you willing to work multiple jobs? That's the role of the man in the marriage relationship, is that he puts some food on the table. That's what the Bible says. Amen. Breathe in, breathe out. It's not the role of the government of our United States to put food on the table. Say amen right there. And you'll get that about 10 o'clock tonight when you lay your head down to sleep. There is a difference also between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman cared for the things of the Lord. Again, there's your single women right there. That she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she that is married careth for the things of the world, how that she may please her husband. You know, you've heard it said that this is a 50-50 split. I say it's a 100-100 split. Both people have to put in 100% in order to get decent results in this marriage relationship. Verse number 35, and this I speak for your own profit, not that I may cast a snare upon you. Look what he says, but for that which is comely, and that ye may attend upon the Lord without distraction. Now, I know the context of the verse. I know exactly what's being said. It's talking about marriage, talking about a husband and wife. But I want to preach for a couple of moments by the help of God on radical distractions of our day. Now, I would be foolish to stand up here today, or tonight rather, and act like there's not distractions in this land that we live in. Amen? We all got cell phones. We're glued to them. Some of you got Facebook. You're texting. You're live streaming. You're running all sorts of things throughout this meeting. And when I sat in the back, you can pay attention. You're probably watching me. I'm making calls. I'm doing running stuff back home and got employees. And it's Friday. People want their checks. And you know, we're collecting checks and all these different things. We got a ton of distraction. Yet you ever hear people talking about how that they're so busy and just didn't have the time to do it? Well, why don't we have the time? God made the world in 6 days and rested on the seventh. And I had to stop myself from saying that. If only there was a little more time in the day, and God pricked my heart. There's exactly enough time in the day that God thinks there ought to be time in the day. And that's what he gave us, a 24-hour day, a 6-day work week, and obviously a day to rest. And I'm not going to get into the whole Sabbath deal, but you understand the context. Listen, we're busy people, but sometimes we allow distractions in our life that are unnecessary distractions. They're radical in the sense that they're extreme distraction because they begin to consume an individual so that they cannot attend on the things which belong to the Lord. Are you distracted tonight? Is your mind clouded with all these different thoughts, with all these different scenarios, with how this whole thing's going to play out? Well, let me give you four characters in your Bible, and then I'll sit down and shut up, and then we'll, I guess, go eat or something. Amen. I'm going to give you four guys that were a little bit distracted in your Bible. Is that all right? Everyone all right out there? Hello, someone throw something. Dean, throw a beer bottle, please. Amen. Throw a beer bottle up here, break it over something, and let's get this party started. Judges, thank you. Thank you, brother. Judges, chapter number 16. Hey, we got to do what we have to. Amen. We're not going to have Barney up here singing I Love You. And so anyways, Judges chapter number 16. I want you to look at a man in your Bible that got a little distracted. This has been preached on, and listen, I'm not one for getting all super spiritual and thinking that I'm going to find God on a big old atlas, and I'm going to nail it down right on the head, and I came to bring revival to you. Listen, I'm the least of everybody in here. Like the brother said, I don't even have the right to be up here preaching by any means, but by God's grace, like Paul said, I am what I am. And so, listen, this has been being said over and over and over and over again today. And if you have ears to hear, you've caught on real soon, good as to what's been said here today. But in Judges chapter number 16, we're going to look at verse number 19. We know here what's going on. This is Samson. Verse number 19, and she made him sleep upon her knees. And she called for a man, and she caused him to shave off the 7 locks of his head, and she began to afflict him, and his strength went from him. One common denominator that you're going to find in all the characters I'm about to give you is that they were asleep. They were asleep at the wheel. So if you're asleep right now, it would do you well to wake up. Amen, amen, amen. But in Judges chapter number 16, Samson here is asleep on Delilah's lap. She has him right where she wants him. The brother just nailed this thing to a T. He's distracted by the pleasures of this life. Now listen, I'm not so naive to stand up here and say that every person in here is living holy and godly for the glory of God. The brothers have been preaching it all day, ringing our bell, shucking the corn, nailing our hide to the wall all day long about this sin issue, about this perversion issue, about this adultery issue, about the fornication issue, about the pornication issue, about your cell phone that you go to sleep with every night. Amen, amen, amen. The Bible says we're not ignorant of his devices. There's one device in this room tonight that I guarantee can get down any man if you'll allow it, and it's a device called a smartphone. Now listen, I know nobody wants to hit this, and we're a bunch of street preachers in here, holier than thou, we never sin, and all this jazz. And listen, you're looking at a ball of flesh from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. I don't apologize for that. I don't expect you to be me. I don't expect you to walk in my shoes. But from the time I got here to this conference, I'm a man, and that's what you're looking at. Amen. Only by the grace of God can I walk in his spirit and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I know some don't like that, and everyone wants to be pious and ignore the fact that a man can mess up. If a man couldn't mess up, there wouldn't be so many warnings and admonitions in that Bible of not to mess up. Are you still there? Caller, are you there? Pleasure, temptations, women, destroying a man. The brother preached it all through Proverbs. He gave that warning to his sons. Why? Because there's real attacks on real men of God that are trying to do right, but we can be distracted by the pleasures of this life, by the pleasures of a woman, by the pleasures of our own flesh, by the pleasures of a smartphone, Facebook. Amen. Listen, I'm not preaching against Facebook. If you want to have it, that's your own prerogative. I just don't want to see any Christian, so-called Christian, with a low-cut t-shirt on there trying to friend everybody. Say amen right there. I know it's late. Listen, we can have a Jerry Springer in here tonight if you want to. But that's what's going on. I got 1,000 friends, and half of them look like God knows what, and they're all messed up, and they're all perverted. You click in one single link, and you can be in the depths of depravity before you know it. Amen. I preached long enough to know that not every man that's out on those streets, upon these corners in this country, and I know I'm hitting her home, but listen, I'm an observant person. That's all I've done since the day I was saved, is observe people, manage people, have employees under me. I watch their ethic. I watch their moral. I watch their conduct. I watch what they do. I watch the way they react. I watch the way they operate. I watch the way they respond. I got 10 employees back home. I've always had 10 employees since the day I got saved and managed companies and gone through all these things. You say, well, what does that mean? I have to study people. Not only that, but I pastor a church and preach on the streets. I deal with people constantly. What I'm saying today is that, that we've been on the streets of America all throughout. And listen, not everybody that I've seen on those streets are walking in what you would call holiness. Amen. Let me just get real plain for you. I believe if you look twice, you already messed up. Breathe in, breathe out. It'll be all right. We'll be out of here before you know it. You say, oh, well, what does this have to do? And I know we got the pious mentality and no one falls and no one sins, like the brother said earlier. That's why God said don't do it, so that way you won't struggle with it. But Samson here is a man of God. The Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord was on him. He killed more men than you would ever think to imagine. He was used by God. He was a judgment against these Philistines. He was God's man for the hour, and he messed up royally. Because he got distracted by pleasure. Pleasure. Are you distracted today? Let me say this, and I know I might lose half of you, but you're gone anyways. He might have been distracted just because she was a woman. Listen, I know men today that are staying home because mama said they can't go out. That ain't the God of the Bible. Hello? That ain't the God of the Bible. If a man can't go out and preach because his wife needs help at the house, that house is messed up. Do you understand what I'm saying? I believe a man ought to be responsible. I believe a man ought to work hard. I believe a man ought to provide. I believe a man ought to do his due diligence in the home and help out and be a joint heir with his wife. But at the same time, my wife don't dictate what events I preach, how I preach, when I preach, and who I preach with. Amen. But women can stop men. I remember asking about a brother, said, hey, where's brother so-and-so? He used to preach this event all the time. Well, you know, his wife really, you know, and whatever. Amen. Amen. That's exactly where we're at. But women in general can control a man to the point where he won't go. We see men not come to church. We see men not do certain things that they used to do. Why? Because if mama's not happy, nobody's happy. My saying is, if God's not happy, nobody's happy. I say we ought to please God and God first. But this thing about pleasure and temptation and love and you single people, don't let your heart be taken over. Don't let your mind be taken over and become distracted with the pleasures of this life. Your brother preached it earlier. Lust of the flesh. Lust of the eyes. Two things right there. You go study this book. You go study this book and see what it has to say about a man. Amen. And listen, I'm not a queer. I want to mark that down right now. Thank God. I need help. Amen. I know, listen, we can all play the holier-than-thou part. I'm not a queer. I'm a man from the top of my head down to the bottom of my feet. And only by the grace of God can I do right. You understand me tonight? And listen, this whole thing about this, you got to deal with yourself personally. Let me just take a detour and curve around the other side since everybody's sleeping anyways. You know why preachers won't go to preachers and talk about their problems, and that's why they get blown out and get messed up and get sideways with God is because we won't let them come talk to us, because the moment they talk to us and try to be transparent about their issue and try to be transparent about what they're struggling with and what they're going through, we ostracize them and say, get out of here. You're done. You're finished. It's over. You're a heathen. You're wicked. You ain't saved. I don't know what you call it. Listen, that book is filled with plenty of examples. You want to go study it, you figure it out, you place your own doctrine, you run your own life, you run your own church. It doesn't matter to me. At the end of the day, I'm going home. But what I'm saying is people don't feel as though they can be open to fix their problems that they have. You understand what I'm saying? There ain't a brother in here that'd go to another brother and talk to him about his problems. You know why? Because as street preachers, guess what? We're more righteous than them all. And we won't restore a brother. We won't pick up a brother. We won't build up a brother. We won't help him get through his situation, his struggle, his burden, his heartache, his heartbreak, the thing that's messing him up. Listen, I'm all for kicking people out. I'm all for getting rid of them, counting them as a heathen. I've counted more people as a heathen than you'd probably dare to. Family fights, family feuds, big old blowout, family reunions, church members mad, moms not talking to their children, children not talking to their mom, sisters not talking to sister. Listen, Jesus said I came to bring a sword. I didn't come to bring peace. I understand that. But if they're a brother and they're sincere and they're genuine and they're saying, look, I just need a little help. I just need a little accountability. I just need someone to be there for me. Why not go the extra mile and help him out? Help her out. We won't do it, though. We're going to say, oh, no, you're wicked. You're messed up. You're sideways. You're all bent out of shape. Look at you. And leave them there to die. Amen. The Bible talks about restoring brothers. Amen. The Bible don't say to count them as a heathen unless they don't repent. If they don't repent, then you get rid of them. You understand what I'm saying? So a lot of people don't feel open to go to any people. You understand what I'm saying? Let me move on since it's going to be nice and quiet and we'll just have a little silent hour of prayer while we're at it. Jonah chapter number 1. Jonah chapter number 1. I know that's a touchy issue. Nobody in this country's touching it. When I seen Brother Ruben's video, the one that he just posted up, listen, it's a reality in our culture to preach on these lines week in and week out. Like he said, maybe you ain't preaching on it because you're doing it. Amen. All right, go to Jonah chapter number 1. I better move on. Jonah chapter number 1. Let me find it. Still in the Bible. Everybody all right out there? All righty. That is in the Bible.
That's a tough one to find it.
Especially with the big old mic in your hand. And a left hand.
Page 1405.
I don't have an NIV. I said that I had to say that for a KJV. Let me find it. Job, Esther, Nehemiah, Ezra. All right, I am a Bible thumper.
After Obadiah, brother.
Obadiah?
I think most people are reading the NIEV,
yeah, that's
New International Eunuch Version.
Obadiah and Micah.
You got that? New International Eunuch Version?
All right, let me find it.
Look at me.
Y'all know it's a eunuch in the church? Be popular.
Sorry, brother. My mind gets distracted, you know, and preaching to the choir. Thank you, brother. Jonah chapter number 1. I'll be done anyways. Don't worry about it. Jonah chapter 1, verse number 5, then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast to what? He was asleep. He was asleep again. So we got Samson asleep right now, and we got Jonah asleep. Again, the radicalism or distraction, radical distractions, however you want to title this, Jonah got distracted here by his own rebellion and disobedience. I like to look at Jonah. I don't judge him so harshly. I don't judge him so critically, because ultimately he got out of that boat. He went down. He got thrown into hell. He got burped out of hell. He went and preached, and revival came to Nineveh. Well, God still used them, amen. That's the way I think of myself. Listen, a lot of times I get burped out of hell, and God might even still use me if he so chooses to. But nonetheless, Jonah here was a hard-headed, self-willed preacher. And it distracted him from what he was supposed to do. He was supposed to be down in Tarshish. He was supposed to be preaching. He was supposed to be talking and being the mouthpiece for God. But because he was hard-headed and self-willed, he got distracted. Now listen, you're looking at the hard head up here, and I'm just being honest with you. I'm being transparent. But we all get to this place. We want to be hard-headed. We want to be self-willed. We want to do our own little show, run our own little thing, have our own little ministry, answer to ourselves and nobody else. We don't want anybody else in our life. What I'm saying today is that because Jonah was hard-headed, he got distracted from what he was supposed to be doing, and that was preaching. Don't let anything ever come in your life that'll distract you and make you hard-headed to where you can't be used of God. Now, let me elaborate for you, since it's late and you're looking at me like deer in the headlight. There are certain men that show up to preach, and they take their own little car and say, Reuben, this is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to do it. To me, that's a self-willed man. You don't get our lodging, you don't get our food, you don't get to fellowship. If you don't want to preach with us, I say take a hike and hit the road. Amen, amen, amen. Reuben didn't say that. I said that, amen. What I'm saying though today is, and listen, I'm not saying everyone has to ride with everybody and sit on one another's laps and do that whole kumbaya stuff. But what I am saying is, if a man's been hitting an event for 30 years, do you think I'm going to show up down on the street and try to make my own event out of an event that he's already been covering for 30 years, and I only show up once every 5 years? And I'm going to try to make it as though it's my event. What I'm saying, though, is if we're hard-headed and self-willed, we're not willing to submit. We're not willing to work as a team. We're not willing to do what is necessary to preach. And people do it all the time. Listen, they don't want to do that. I don't want to be there. We don't want to pray. We don't want to go down there. We don't want to preach. We don't want to walk the death march. We don't want to do that. We don't want to be out there 16 hours. We don't want to walk in the rain. We just want to do our little thing. And what I'm saying is, because you're hard-headed, it can distract you from what God wants to do in your life. If you're hard-headed today on a specific area, on a specific doctrine, the brother preached it earlier about he that hateth his brother. You know why you have issues one to another? Because you're hard-headed. You don't want to fix it. You being hard-headed and self-willed and not wanting to fix an issue between another brother, or will they stop talking to me first? That sounds like a bunch of soap opera. That sounds like a bunch of women's tales. Amen. It ought not be said of a man of God. If I want to talk to a brother, I'll go up and talk to him. And listen, if we got to go our separate ways, so be it. But if I want to, I'm not going to sit here on the defensive like, well, brother, they're there and I'm here and they don't want to talk to me and I don't want to talk to him. Be a man about it. Shake somebody's hand. Say hello. Don't let your hard-headedness distract you from preaching and doing the work of God. Anyways, that went over well. I got to move on. I know you're tired, amen. You've already been taking preaching all day. Go over to Matthew chapter number 26. Matthew chapter number 26. I can find Matthew for the record. Matthew chapter number 26. I'm turning with my left hand. That's my problem. Thank you, brother. Matthew 26, look at it, verse number 36. I'm going to take a drink of water. Matthew 26, 36. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful, and were very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and what? Watch with me. That's an action word. He expected them to take action as to what they were doing. So he goes out and prays, and he comes back in verse number 40. Then he cometh to the disciples and findeth them asleep. You notice the common denominator of these people being distracted? One reason I believe Peter got distracted is because the pressure, the persecution that was coming on him. Jesus talks about the seed and the sower. He talks about certain people being persecuted and turning away from the faith. There's people not here today because that they were persecuted, because that they were hated, because that they were jailed, because that they were thrown out of a city, because that they suffered from a loss from their family, saying we want nothing to do from you. And that can distract you from serving the Lord the way you ought to. Peter went to sleep. Jesus is about to die on the cross. He's snoozing while Jesus is in agony, sweating drops of blood. The Bible says he crashed down. Sleep, by the way, is inattentive or unconcerned. That's what the definition for sleep is. One more verse and then I'll sit down. Go to Acts. We'll find another sleeping man here. Acts chapter number 20. Some of you know what's going on here. Acts chapter number 20 and verse number 9. And this is what I see all over this country. And there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, being fallen into a what? Deep sleep. There he is, asleep again. All of these are Christian. All of these are godly men. As Paul was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up. Another area we can get distracted is in preaching. Now listen, I'm a preacher. That's what I do, whether it's on the street or whether it's in a church house. The one area that's lacking, listen, the heathen take the preaching all day long. One area that's lacking is right here in a church house. We can sit there and dish it out for 8 to 10 to 12 hours on the street, but when somebody gets up filled with the Holy Ghost, Ghost of God, points their finger at us, we don't want to take the preaching. We cannot, most of us, take the kind of preaching we dish out. And Eutychus sat up in that window. He fell asleep. He got distracted because he's so fat on the gospel. He's so filled up on the grace of God. He's so full of the Bible. He knows all the verses. Got it all figured out. Got all his doctrine settled. He knows everything, when to come, when to go, what to say, what to do, how to preach, how to do this. And he got fat on the gospel. dozed off in the church house and fell three stories. What I'm saying is, there's some radical distractions out there. You go study it. You go figure it out. Don't be distracted from serving the Lord.